I'm very pleased to be here with Janice. Janice is a friend and a wonderful writer. This is her third book, and we're going to unveil it as well as it will be launched. So, yeah, great. Yeah. Was that she inverts she inverts the intimate eye of love. Now when you read the book you'll understand what I mean, because what she's done is told a story about love. It's told through 9 different people who have been in love with the same woman. So their first person narratives told one after the other. And we get to find out about this woman through these stories. And the woman is quite distant in a way. We know that she likes cats. We know that she can do origami. We know that she likes the water and is respectful of it. So we slowly gather these pieces about the woman. And I wonder if you could start, Janice, by telling us something about why you chose this particular structure to tell the story.
Is this on? Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, so thank you, Tishani. It's so lovely to be here to begin with before I get to your question. And so much fun. We get together when she's in Delhi or when I'm in Chennai, and we talk about books, we talk about literature, and it's just really nice to be able to share that with you all here. So thanks, and thanks for being here. To go back to your question, it has a little bit to do with, well, the origins of the book. And the idea for the book actually came to me on a very cold, slightly grey London evening when I was walking after dinner through the city with somebody who I thought I would be in a long, long-term relationship with. And I realized that actually it was ending. It was unraveling, and we had reached a point where we could go no further. And I found myself wandering the streets with him by my side, thinking, how did I get here? How did this happen? What are the stories that he is telling about me? In fact, what are the stories that everyone I've ever loved or been with, what are they saying about me? And I think that might explain why the structure of the book is one of being on the outside looking in. As Tishani so nicely put it, it is turning the eye of love inside out. The reason why I think I chose to do this was for a number of reasons. One, because I really wondered why people do what they do. We spend most of our lives not really understanding everyone entirely. And for me, it was really important to try and get a sense of, well, my life or this particular life in told through love. And that's how the structure sort of came about, that my empathy would not be with the woman at the center as much as the ones who were looking at her, who were recalling their time with her. The other reason that I chose to structure the book in this way was because I was worried that, I was concerned that a first-person narrative might nudge this very firmly into the realm of memoir. That it really would cease in a way to be fiction, that the I would be too strong it would be too much me.
Yeah? On the very first page of the book, there is a line. I have a sorrowful feeling that this is the only time in their lives they will do art, and that they will grow up and plunge into vocations that do not call for beauty. This is the art teacher. The girl is 9?
She's 11.
And this is where she is discovering that while she's really bad at painting, she's very good at origami. I want to ask you about the word beauty, because I read your previous novel, Sequels, which is all about art and beauty and love. And here on the very first page, you have asserted in a way that beauty will be at the center of this book somehow. So I know it's an abstract question, but I would like you to talk a little bit about beauty and why it's so important for you.
Well, the first chapter, as Tishani was just explaining, is told through the eyes of the girl's art teacher. And in some ways, the first chapter is also slightly, for lack of a better phrase, anti-beauty in that sense. Because, as you mentioned, she's terrifically awful at painting, at sketching, at doing the usual things that call for a sense of aesthetic, that call for a sense of, plunging into your imagination untethered. And the reason perhaps why she prefers origami, of course, is perhaps because it works by instruction. And I guess, as Amrita, you were just talking in the previous session about how a lot of us live in a time where we like to know what we're doing. We don't want to venture into the unfamiliar and the unknown, where perhaps the woman at the center of the novel is a bit like that. And she tries to access beauty within a very instructed, prescribed way, because she feels safer in that sense. So yes, beauty is at the heart of the novel, this one as much as with Seahorse. I think that the characters in both the books kind of access it or make their journey towards it in very, very different ways. But the reason why I guess beauty is at the heart of the books is because it's something that's deeply important to me. I think perhaps a little like the protagonist. There is a sense of order, there is a sense of symmetry that might be broken by something slightly asymmetrical that gives you a sense that the world is in its place, that there is there are many things that are happening around that, outside that we cannot control. That we might want to be with people who do not want to be with us, that we want to write that book, but it just won't come to us. But this placing of beauty at the center of your life gives you a kind of control, a kind of sense of order, a kind of sense of things being in place, in proper place.
Now I'm going to ask you a difficult question, and it's slightly an annoying one. I'm sorry to have to do it, because I really hate to be asked this question. And you said memoir, and you said that we know each other very well. So therefore, Janice, reading your book, I was going, aha. But the question I want to ask is, it's a really annoying question when people ask writers how much of this is real, like how much is this from your...
But I have an answer for that. I've decided that I will answer 82.3%
of... No, that's too easy. I won't let you get away with that. Because it's a valid question. I think the reason why writers get annoyed is because it implies a lack of imagination. And also because they don't want to reveal their tricks, as it were. Margaret Atwood said something very beautiful. She said, there has to be a little bit of blood in the gingerbread man for him to come alive. And I thought that sense of when you write from life, there is a believability thing that, as a reader, it doesn't matter if it's real or not, but you feel something. So I want you to talk a little bit about what it means to write from life and how you transform it into fiction.
Okay. There was this article that I was doing a couple of months ago, and it was an article on how writers write about love. As you know, because I did ask Tishani as well, how do you write about love? And I asked a whole bunch of writer friends, how do you write about love? Actually, Manu Joseph had something very interesting to say, and something that I resonated with very deeply. He said that when I write about love, love is always autobiography. It cannot be anything else. And I thought that very, very, very much, especially for this book, it is true for me as well. Because love as an emotion, as a feeling, as a space, as a state of being, is so deeply inherent, it's so deeply embedded, that it cannot come from anyone else in that sense. And so, as you said, how does it get transformed into fiction? In a way, it's culled from you, and it is shared. I think that's the only way that I can say it. I don't think it's ever given away to your characters, but it's shared with your characters. Because, as you said, also, that's what you want your readers to feel. You know, Tolstoy had this very, very interesting paragraph in this little book called What is Art? And he said that the only art that matters, the only art that is good art, is the art that makes the recipient infected by the artist. That if that does not happen, good art has not been created. So there is this idea of contagion that comes in, that whether it's love, or whether it's loss, or whether it's humiliation, or fear, or anger, if it's not, I guess, maybe coming from you, or coming from some sort of experience that you've had as a 5-year-old, as a 13-year-old, as a 37-year-old, perhaps Tolstoy was right, that then the blood in the gingerbread man is missing, that infection, that contagion cannot happen. And I think sometimes writing from what you've experienced, what you've felt, lends an urgency to the prose or the poetry that maybe is missing in writing that maybe is a little more distant to you. I'm not sure. It's how I feel about my writing in particular.
In that essay about love, which was wonderful, you said everything I've ever written about has been about love.
Yes.
And I think when I read Seahorse as well, which also has a love story at the center of it, there is this kind of insistence on love. And even in this book, which is really about love, but in fact, none of the stories last. It's more about love that is sort of fleeting or undeparted in a way?
Because I think this book is about love at its heart, but also about the practice of love in that sense, the relationships that we have through love, via love, in love. I think that was what I was deeply excited to explore. What are the patterns that we fall into? Who are the people who never leave, who kind of turn up like ghosts in our lives? What does that say about us? What does that say about them? How do we practice love? How do we go about sort of, putting it into place in our lives through other people who we love and desire and want to be with? I think that's what sort of I was trying to explore how love is practiced.
Yes, and I love the idea as well that no matter how much you love someone, there is also the sense that you never actually know everything that's inside their head and what they're thinking about you. So in that sense, it's a great work of the imagination. But also to understand that these things are electrical. So in terms of structure, you have it's fragmented. So we are only getting pieces. Tell me about this, because in your it's also very linear. You begin, it's almost chronological. And it's very different in structure from C-course, which I thought was quite experimental. The time, the way that you dealt with time was very different in that novel. So was it a conscious decision to sort of go in a more straightforward fashion through time?
Well, I think in terms of, you know, theme and sort of subject matter, this book is very, very different to my first, which is Books on Land. But in terms of structure, especially temporal structure, they're very similar. Books on Land is almost this sort of sociological, exercise. It kind of excavates this region for us very precisely in terms of time, from sort of the mid-1850s to sort of contemporary now. And of course it does that for a region, for a place, or for places. But this one does possibly the same thing in almost this obsessive, precise manner with one life, or even a particular section of a life. So it's almost as though it's really honed in, it's really sort of zeroed in on one individual. And you're right, with Seahorse, because it's very much about memory and the slippages of memory, it took on that structure of sort of cyclical repetition and echoing. Time just seems to turn in on itself and loop around on itself, and it's very cyclical in structure. But I think why I needed to do this for this particular novel was to follow the trajectory of her understanding of love in a very, very sort of organized, precise way, because I felt like it was the only way with which echoes could sort of come together and work together. I couldn't see it in any other way apart from a very linear movement of this one character from here to there. And also, I think structurally it would have been quite difficult for a reader to follow if it's 9 different people talking in 9 different time zones.
Although the butcher makes a second appearance, I'll ask you about that later. But I'd love for you to read something from the book so that people can get a sense now of the key words in the language.
So we've been talking about how all of these people seem to be in love with our protagonist, but that's not entirely true. There are characters also who like her, who are fascinated by her, but who she is much more in love with than they are. So I'm going to read from a section a little later in the book called The Florist. And it's right here, I think. Maybe not right there. Gosh, Amrita, you can find a poem, I can find a chapter.
Don't give
this
up.
This is crazy.
Here we are.
It's here, I found it. So it's from a section called The Florist. How do I tell you this is not love? It isn't. It cannot be. If I'd known, I wouldn't have walked into that pub. No, that's not true. I would have walked into that pub and watched you and then slipped away quietly. This is also untrue. I'm not the kind to think too much about anything. I like surfing and motorbikes and drinking beer with my friends on weekends. I work with machines. The only books I read are self-help books. The one is about cheese or something. My parents are divorced. I'm close to my mother, I have an elder sister and a dog at home. Once a year, I take a holiday during the summer, usually to the seaside. I like traveling and I would venture to unlike places if I can afford to. When I find the one I want to marry, I will take her away and propose to her on a gondola. That's my idea of romance, and that's really all there is to know about me. I don't much like the city I live and work in now, filled with stone bridges. I come from the eternal city, to the south, and I miss it, but for now I cannot return. Believe me when I say I will not forget you. I do not love you, but I will not forget you. How can I? For a few days, it is true, you lifted me out of myself. It's one of those afternoons in July when you can really feel it's building up to the hottest time of the year. The tourists are going crazy and so are the hawkers. Queues wind for miles outside every sightseeing spot in the city. I'm used to it by now and I know which streets to avoid. I park my car on a road close to the pub and I walk. It's Saturday. I'm happy to be off work. I have the weekend to myself and I've come to watch tennis at the only place in the city that's showing the match. This English pub, or an English pub as it's imagined to be here on the continent, all wood paneled, beer on tap, leather sofas. There aren't many people inside. Most come to this city to see art, architecture, and a couple of guys hitting a fluorescent ball over a net isn't quite on the agenda. You are sitting at the bar in a white dress with pale blue flowers. Your feet are clad in summer sandals, your hair falls to your shoulders, your arms are tanned and bare. Sitting, you appear small. Before you, a tall pint and a bowl of crisps. You have your back to me, you're watching the match intently. I cannot see your face. At first, I'm intrigued because you're the only woman here and I wonder if you are beautiful, if you have a face I will not forget. Then you turn to speak to the bartender. Your cheeks are flushed as if you've been out in the sun for too long, but your eyes are wide and bold and dark as nights that carry promise. You glance around the pub at the other two men watching the game, and then at me. You look a moment, and you smile.
I wanted to ask about why the book is so untethered to any kind of name of a place or a date. It's just sort of floating. Is there a reason?
A few. I think if you placed boats on land and Nine Chambered Heart on some sort of geographical sort of spectrum, boats on land would be on one end and the Nine Chambered Heart, as you observed, would be on the far, far other side. At the far sort of other end. Boats on land is deeply, deeply geographically anchored. It's very much stories that grew out of a place, and not just a place, but a place at a very, very particular time. I think a few things happened when I wrote that book. I started, for one, being labeled a Northeast writer, sometimes even a Northeast woman writer. And for me personally, I'm deeply uncomfortable with labels. I find them extremely essentializing and restrictive. And I don't quite see how they're useful apart from being convenient for the marketing department, to be honest. So I think in a lot of ways, my writing after that has been little acts of rebellion. The seahorse sort of moves away from the Northeast quite deliberately, to be honest. And also because I felt like it was a story that couldn't quite be set in the places where I'd grown up. And this, as Tishani says, is anchorless. It loads. And I think at one level it's me sort of saying, well, now make what you will of this. Because what genre even, what category are you going to put me into after this? In fact, Seahorse was a love story, and it's a love story about between two men, and most people found that very disconcerting. In fact, I had readers come up to ask me, why are you writing about homosexual men? They just couldn't wrap their heads around it. Of course, my answer to them will always be that it's just about love. That's a good point. Why are we so keen and so quick to slap a label on everything? So 19 with Heart is, of course, my little act of rebellion. But apart from that, I remember being in conversation with Panjum Hassan a few years ago, and we were talking about stories that do precisely this, that kind of remain geographically unanchored, like your fairy tales, your 1001 Nights, stories that kind of drift over borders, across languages. And I started thinking about, well, what kind of stories can survive this? What kind of stories can survive this untethering, this loosening, this art? Does it survive? Does it transform into something else? What kind of story does it become at the end? Will it work? That was the question that I asked up to the day that I sent the manuscript out. I didn't know, but I just thought, well, if I don't do this now, I'll never find out.
I wanted to talk about vulnerability and writing, because it seems to me that this book is very vulnerable. Book somehow is very powerful. There is a lot of you in it, and I don't think it's because I've gotten to know you better over the time. I think it's a very direct book, in a way that Seahorse is much more distant in a way. It's looking at the story from above, and this is very much inner, like being inside this nine-chambered heart. So, as a writer who's written this dear girl book, moving through genres also, going from short stories, you also write poetry and fiction. What is the role of vulnerability? How do you deal with it?
I think all writing is actually vulnerability, because it's placing yourself out into the world where you're in the hands of absolute strangers, or family, or friends. Sometimes that's even harder. So I think writing by itself is just an act of vulnerability. And I think if you can't sort of be comfortable or sort of in a way okay with that, you don't know if one can write. At least I don't think it would be possible for me, because it does come, like you said, we draw from life to sort of create our poetry, and I draw from life to really create the books that I write. And that by itself means that I am sending this out into the world with mostly a prayer, that's about it. But I don't think that can be taken away. And I think if that's taken away from me, I wouldn't be able to write the way I do, or to write what I do. It's, again, And to go back to what we were talking about, false joy and infection and contagion, I think that's it. If you're doing this, you might as well do this all the way. And just be honest and raw and truthful about it.
I think when you publish your first book, there's a sense of naivete about what's going to happen, and also a freedom when you write your first book, because you have no idea what it will be like. You also, I don't think, necessarily think of who is going to receive that book. But as you go through writing book after book, have you had a sense of audience or writer or who's going to read it? Does that come into your mind when you write it all?
I think for Seahorse, in fact, it was very much a book that, I thought about a lot when it came to audience. Who's going to read this? I was living in the UK and I was feeling, anyway, quite displaced from my readers who are mostly here. The people that I work for, I write for, are here, and I was living elsewhere, and that was very much in my mind. Who am I writing this for? How should I write this for what seems to be a whole new audience elsewhere? And I think it affected the book. Very much so. It becomes a book. It's not a bad book, but I think it becomes a book that's very self-aware of it being a book. Does that make sense? It's very aware of it. Of course, it's also a first novel. So I think it's very aware of that, and it's trying to be a novel. And it's like Jude said. He said, "I think you were writing Seahorse with a lot of other writers looking over your shoulder." So even if it wasn't so much about audience at times, it was also about who was looking over my shoulder as I was writing the book. But I think, and this is a little sort of quotidian and mundane and very unpoetic, I think, but I think it also mattered that I didn't have a job then. I was making my living from writing, and I placed a tremendous amount of pressure on my writing, and at least for me, it really changed my relationship with writing in a way that I wasn't quite comfortable or happy with. Coming back to it, in the sense that I felt that I was always writing then for some other purpose apart from just enjoying what I was doing and writing because I wanted to write and because these are the stories that I wanted to tell. Then it becomes very much about audience and how are you writing and, you know, thinking about where to place this book and where to sort of send it out to. And I think for me it was deeply disquieting and uncomfortable. And again, like I was saying, it's slightly unpoetic, but I came back to India and I got a job. I started teaching at a university just outside Delhi, and it was a job that actually allowed me to have this kind of convenient arrangement between time at university and time at home. And suddenly I felt quite free. My relationship with my writing came back to what it was, I think, before Seahorse. And with this book, and this is again what Jade said, it's a book where there aren't that many writers, in fact there aren't any writers looking over your shoulder at all, that it comes from a space of less fear, I think.
Thank you very much.